Good morning and welcome everyone to the 34th meeting of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee. Our first agenda item is a declaration of interests. Can I welcome Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, MSP, to the committee and invite Mr. Halcrow-Johnson to make a declaration of any registrable interests that are relevant to the remit of the committee. Mr. Halcrow-Johnson.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Just a couple of interests that would be relevant, I think. I am the partner in an agricultural farming business, J. Halcrow Johnson and Sons, and I also own agricultural land in Orkney and a croft in Orkney, and I'm a member through my farming interests of a number of farming and countryside related groups such as NFU and Scottish Land and Estates.
Thank you very much. That's duly noted. The next agenda item is to take evidence on the Scottish Government's legislative consent memorandum on the UK Government's Future Agreement Relationship Bill, following the recent agreement between the European Commission and the UK Government prior to the end of the transition period tomorrow. Can I welcome to the meeting Michael Russell, MSP, the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs, Mike Nielsen, head of the EU Directorate with the Scottish Government, Gerard Byrne, the team leader for Constitution Policy, and Graham Fisher, the interim deputy director of the Legal Directorate, Constitutional and Civil Law with the Scottish Government. And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, please?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to appear before you today. I wish it was under different circumstances. This marks essentially the end both of membership of the EU and of transition, something that Scotland did not vote for, and it is happening in almost the worst possible way. Members will have had a chance, I hope, just to read the Scottish Government's Legislative Consent Memorandum for the Future Relationship Bill, and I want to thank my officials who have worked extraordinarily hard on this, given that we only saw the bill in draft form less than 48 hours ago. We recommend, on the basis of the bill and on two grounds I shall outline, that consent be refused. Firstly, the content of the deal between the EU and the UK, which this bill implements, is unacceptable. The Scottish Government's position on Brexit has been well rehearsed. We would rather Brexit did not happen, but if it must happen, then we put forward balanced proposals that would limit the damage to Scotland. Those proposals were never given any serious consideration by the UK Government. Instead, the UK Government pursued an increasingly hard Brexit, pretty much now as hard as one could imagine, short of a no deal. Our initial critique of the deal is set out in the memorandum, and I hope that our detailed analysis is helpful to members. Suffice it to say that Scotland will be much worse off than we were when the UK was a member state, and that the promises of those who championed Brexit have been broken, just alas, as many of us predicted they would. The second reason for withholding consent is the extraordinary lack of proper scrutiny this bill will be given in the time available. This lack of time is entirely of the UK government's making. An extension to the transition period was perfectly possible, and the Scottish Parliament supported it. This bill, if passed, will implement a deal running to over 1,200 pages. It will give wide-ranging powers to UK ministers. It will affect every area of life in Scotland for years to come. A bill of that significance cannot be scrutinised. It cannot be scrutinised between Christmas Eve and Hogmanay. It is an impossibility. Now, I will, of course, be happy to answer the committee's questions. However, we've only heard about the outcome of negotiations via the media on Christmas Eve, like everybody else. As I said, we didn't receive even an in-confidence version of the deal documentation until Christmas Day. We only received the full copy of the bill in draft form the first time late on the evening before last. So I would ask members to bear that in mind. And if there are questions that we cannot presently ask, then we will try to answer them at a later date. But members should be aware of where the responsibility for that lies. It lies squarely with Boris Johnson and his government.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And yes, congratulations to your officials on turning round the LCM in record time. I did have an opportunity to read it last night, but I agree with you that the timing for scrutiny is certainly unacceptable. If I could just maybe highlight some of the aspects that you've raised in your analysis in the LCM, starting with fishing. Just last month, the Scottish Fishermen's Federation submitted evidence to this committee in which they said, and I quote, "We welcome the UK government's position that getting the right deal on fishing is not a matter of expedience, but a matter of principle." They have now made it clear just how disappointed they are. So can I ask, what principles do you think the UK government applied with regards to fishing in this deal?
I think the only principle they applied was to get a deal. I think it's been obvious for some time, and I think this is borne out now by what we see, that the only way Boris Johnson could in the end get a deal was to give up on some of his significant red lines. Now, of course, when the UK joined the old European Common Market in 1973, it was the Scottish fishermen that were sacrificed. And many of us feared that the Tories would do exactly the same, but I don't think any of us felt they would do so in such a barefaced fashion. In order to get this deal, they had to give up, essentially, on what they wanted on fisheries, as in lots of other areas, and that's what they did. I have friends in Brussels I was talking to in the last few days, all of whom's opinion was the same. The EU got everything that was in Barnier's mandate. The EU did very well out of it. And the UK and the UK government are spinning a line about how well they've done, because they've done very badly, and particularly badly by Scotland fishermen, I have to say. It is utterly shocking, the position that they have been left in.
Thank you very much for that. And at the moment, of course, Scottish ministers do have a role in fishing talks with the EU, or did when we were a member. And that's, I want to talk about the governance framework going forward that will oversee this agreement, which doesn't include Scotland in any shape or form, either for fishing or any other devolved area. I understand it has a partnership council at its head, with representatives of the Commission and a UK government minister, and 19 subject committees and 4 working groups, some of which will look at devolved areas. What representation has the Scottish government made regarding these arrangements, or did you know that these were the arrangements that were going to be put in place, and how does it compare to how Scotland might be represented in Europe as a full member state?
Well, as a full member state, you're represented in a number of different ways, including in the Parliament, in the Commission, and of course, many people working in there. We did not know that this was a structure then. We didn't know what was in the deal. I mean, you know, we've not been consulted on it, despite the fact that I'm a member of the Joint Ministerial Committee on European Negotiations, which was, by its own remit, meant to have oversight negotiations. That has never happened. Fortunately, you know, we are on the ball already. There was a joint ministerial committee yesterday late afternoon, a point I made forcibly, and I have to say it was made also by Jeremy Miles for Wales and by Arlene and Michelle from Northern Ireland, was that there needed to be representation from the devolved governments in this entire structure, and particularly where there were devolved responsibilities that were considered by the structure. And I pointed out yesterday something which Michael Gove appeared to accept, but then it doesn't matter to him what he accepts. It usually just doesn't happen. He appeared to accept that there was a read across from the structures that were established to the intergovernmental review, which is still incomplete. It's been going on for 2.5 years, the intergovernmental review. And I don't believe the intergovernmental review can be resolved unless there is now an acknowledgement of the read across to the structures within the agreement. And of course, the foundational stone of this in terms of precedent will come from the presence of Scottish ministers at European councils, which was, when the UK was attending European councils, always something that we sought to have. It was on a grace and favour basis, and that was utterly wrong, but ministers did attend. I myself have attended Environment Council, I've attended Education Council. And there, in terms of fishing talks, then a Scottish minister has always, I think probably since devolution, but certainly since we came into government, attended those fishing talks. Not always in the room. There have been sessions absolutely just gracefully when the Scottish minister represents 60% or more of the fishing interest has been excluded, but has been there and will have to continue to be involved in that way. Now, I suspect what we will hear is a commitment to that. But, you know, the experience of the last 4 years means that my view is that commitments from the UK government are worthless. They need to be tied to this, and we need to make sure that it happens, and it'll be very hard to do so.
Yeah, thank you very much. A big change. Now, there's many more things I'd like to ask you about, but we have a full committee this morning and everybody's keen to ask questions, so I'll come back with supplementaries later if there's time, and now move on to Claire Baker.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, first maybe I'd like to ask a question about the LCM and the paper that was produced last night, I believe. I do appreciate how hard the officials have worked on trying to prepare papers for the Scottish Parliament. In the document at paragraph 23, it does explain that this is only an initial analysis of provisions and effects on devolved competence. And I can appreciate that given the timescales we have faced. When do you think officials will be able to prepare a more thorough analysis of what the impact is? Or we had evidence from our advisors this morning that there's still quite a bit of the deal that's not clear. We know that the services, if part of it isn't as strong as what we need to see, there's still some questions outstanding. So when do you think we would be able to have a proper understanding of what the impact will be?
It is a very good question, but a very difficult question to answer for the reasons that you've given and for other reasons. I heard Ian Duncan Smith on Radio 4 this morning when I was driving from a very cold Argyll, saying that his opinion was that the deal restored sovereignty, but then there were things in it that were problematic, but they could be resolved later. Now, I've no idea what he means by that, but there are things in the document that are not yet tied down. But I think also the implication was that he could see the Conservatives trying to change details of the deal, even though this deal will be signed today, we understand. So on one side, it will take some time for the things that are still not tied down to be tied down. Some may never be tied. If you look, for example, at the mutual recognition of professional qualifications, that exists in the CETA treaty as well, but it's never been actioned and may never be actioned. So there may be things that just never happen. In terms of what is actually in the 1,200 pages, again, I made the point to Michael Gove yesterday that what will require to be done is very detailed briefing by officials, to officials, for a long period of time on all the complex detail. Now, as that goes on, we will publish what we have and our understandings. We will try and publish more on this reasonably soon, but it will require us to dig in some depth, and some of the stuff is deliberately, I think deliberately vague. In fact, it's taken a real expert or a real group of experts 4 days to reveal the awful nature of the fishing deal. I fear within the deal there will be many other things which turn out to be pretty sour for those who have to experience them. But we will go through the deal, we will do our best, we will try and provide information, but there are some things we may never know and may never have.
Thank you. The other issue is around while people might need time, businesses have to make changes from the 1st of January when the bill is introduced. And whether do you think the deal answers some of the questions that businesses and sectors were bringing to the committee in our recent inquiries? And what do you anticipate the situation being at the borders, particularly in Cian Ryan? How do you anticipate the border regime operating from the 1st of January and whether businesses feel ready to make the necessary changes?
Well, I thought Michael Heseltine's remark about the nature of the deal was a good one. There's of course a sense of relief, as he put it. I think that if you're not going to be hanged, you're relieved even if you have life imprisonment. And there's a relief from businesses that they now know the awful truth. Whether they are prepared now for the inevitable disruption that will take place, and that is inevitable. I mean, the EU have said so. Michael Gove himself talked, I think, on the front page of the Times yesterday about a bumpy ride. He didn't say how bumpy, nor did he say how long that would be for. So we will have to wait and see. There was the disruption last week at Kent was an indication of how things could go badly wrong very, very quickly. I mean, that happened, in a matter of 24 hours. The volume will be less this on Friday and into the weekend. Many companies will have taken the steps they need to take, though some will not know what those steps are. Others will not have. The Northern Ireland situation is fluid. The protocol, of course, takes precedence. As far as the protocol is concerned, I heard yesterday of one company, a mail order company, that was not accepting orders from Northern Ireland because they didn't think it could deliver them. And there's a lot of effort, I know, going in to try from the Northern Ireland executive, amongst others, to try and tell people what they can and can't do. But there is going to be confusion, undoubtedly. But the whole context of this is absolutely unnecessary. We didn't vote for it. And it will be worse than what we have. I mean, the real point we should hold on to is on Friday, what we will have will be significantly and permanently, until we're able to rejoin, permanently worse than what we have now. And anybody who has negotiated that should hang their head in shame.
And are you, just convener, if I might just ask, are you having regular discussions with the ports and with the border agencies around how we mitigate, how we manage what will happen over the next week or so?
Well, we're having regular discussions with the ports that we can. We're part of we've been attending the EXO meetings, the UK government meetings on exit, and those will continue. And we constantly seek information, but you don't constantly get information, unfortunately. So we also have, as you know, and I've reported to the Chamber, I think, twice on this, we have set up our own concurrent risk structure. You know, we are very aware of what the risk could be, and we are cited on that and prepared for that. But we cannot be prepared for everything.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Claire. Dean Lockhart next.
Thank you very much, Chair. Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us this morning. In recent weeks, you have said that any deal would be better than a no deal, and the First Minister said that a no deal would be catastrophic. But we've just heard from you that the SNP will vote against the legislative consent motion this evening and will be voting for a no deal Brexit. The context is that our European friends, including the European Commission President, has said this is a good, fair and balanced deal, and leading EU commentators have said that it's a sensational deal for the UK, with full economic access to the EU without tariffs and without quotas. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to explain why the SNP has made this extraordinary U-turn and will vote against the deal and become the party of a no-deal Brexit?
It really isn't a question. It's probably not even worth responding to, given the misrepresentation that is within it. But let me do my very best. First of all, which leading economists have lauded this as a wonderful deal? I'd be interested to have a list of them. If I were the president of the European Commission or Michel Barnier or anybody else, I think it was a great deal, because everything that was within his mandate has been achieved. But if it's a great deal for them, it is not a great deal for us. But actually, the deliberate misrepresentation that you've been guilty of there, Mr. Lockhart, is a lack of knowledge of how treaties are done. This is, and as you are a lawyer and apparently one of them advised the UK government in some form, I find that astonishing that you don't know that or are pretending not to know that. Because treaties are done usually by the prerogative. And indeed, Boris Johnson could sign this afternoon without even bothering to put it to the House of Commons, because it is an international agreement, an international law. It will be signed by the President of the Commission, and it will be signed by Johnson, and that's it. So, you know, no matter what people vote, it is going to happen, regrettably. That is the society which the Conservatives have created, an anti-democratic society that they have created. And I do think it's pretty shameful that any elected politician would back that up. So the reality of the situation is your question is based on a number of false premises, and I think you really could do better.
Well, Cabinet Secretary, one of the premises of my question was that this is a win-win outcome for Scotland, for the UK and for the European Union, and a number of commentators across the UK, across Scotland, the CBI, the British...
They're not independent commentators. They're a business organisation. I mean, get your definitions.
I'd rather take their word than yours, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, let me move on to the second question. This deal allows us to enter into future free trade agreements with third countries across the world. Scotland's trade with the rest of the UK, as you know, is worth 23% of our trade compared to 16% of our trade with the European Union. And a number of new free trade agreements have recently been entered into with Japan, which is the fourth largest market for Scotch whisky, with Singapore, which is the third largest market for Scotch, with Canada and a number of other countries. But the SNP has voted against and failed to support all of those free trade agreements. Can you please explain why?
Well, for a start, your definitions continue to be rather strange, and I can only think you either don't understand or deliberately misleading. These are not new free trade arrangements. These are continuation arrangements. The one with Turkey that was signed, I think, this weekend could only be signed after there was a deal with the EU, and this is a continuation arrangement. There are very small increases in trade in the Japanese one from the continuation agreement, which appear to be largely to do with Stilton cheese. But then, you know, fine, if that's what they want to sell, great. We've not voted against trade deals. We've made it clear that there is a far better set of deals which we are leaving and leaving behind. If I may quote the, I think it was a French ambassador to the United States, who said it was hardly service to free trade to walk away from the biggest free trade bloc in the world. And of course, you know, it is an utter perversion of the truth to argue that in some sense, because we are against giving up the benefits that we have, that in some sense we're against trade itself. That is, I think this is the third time you have put that ludicrous point to me, and it's the third time which I am glad to call ludicrous.
Well, I'm asking just for a factual yes or no. Did the SNP fail to support those free trade agreements? Yes or no?
I'm not going to give you a yes or no, because all you're trying to do is to have an unjustifiable argument. If you can argue the benefits of this agreement to Scottish fishermen, to the young people who are badly affected, to the businesses that will be suffering, then argue that benefit. But if it's such a great deal, why are you so angry at the people who are voting against it? Surely you would want to take ownership. You know this is an utterly rotten deal. It is an appalling deal. And you are an apologist for an appalling deal that will damage Scottish business and damage Scotland. You should hang your head in shame.
Cabinet Secretary, as I said, I will follow the advice of leading business organisations, but I think my time is up and I will hand it back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now have Ross Greer as our next questioner.
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, you've already answered my first question, which was around no deal and the fact it's not possible for anyone to vote for no deal at this stage. The UK government, under its executive powers, is ratifying this agreement. Parliaments are voting on enabling legislation and the effect it has on devolved competencies in our case. Can I ask, my second question is around the wider macroeconomic effects of this. My skim reading understanding of this deal is that it's relatively, not comprehensive, but relatively sufficient in terms of trading goods, of course, an area in which the EU has a surplus of trade to the UK. What it does not cover is trade in services, where the UK and Scotland have a surplus to the EU. Can I just ask for your thoughts on what the overall economic effect of a deal that emphasises goods over services is going to be on our economy?
Perhaps, convener, I could ask Mike Nielsen to respond to this. Mike has spent an enormous amount of time over the festive season perusing the deal, and as the head of our office in Brussels, he has excellent contacts and will have been able to inform him. So perhaps I could ask Mike to say a word or two on this.
Okay, thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. The only, I think, point to make initially is, I think that probably more accurate to say that the services provisions are worse than the goods provisions, which themselves do not provide full economic access, given that there's probably four components of full economic access for goods. One is tariffs and quotas, which this deal covers. The other three are rules of origin, customs arrangements, and regulatory rules. And each of those three areas, the outcome is substantially worse than for the existing EU membership. On services, the arrangements are very limited, and while they do ensure non-discrimination, it leaves Scottish and UK businesses in a position where they have to comply with the domestic rules of whichever country they're operating in, rather than being able to work on the basis of their home country authorizations. So those are the sort of overall outcomes. You're probably aware that the work that Swiss government has done suggests that a deal of this nature will push down economic growth by about 6% by 2030. And the Office of Budget Responsibility at UK level suggests it will reduce things by 4%, which is better than no deal, but still a very substantial and permanent hit.
Thank you, and thank you, Mike, for putting the work in on this between Christmas and New Year. Can I ask, in terms of the analysis that the Scottish Government had done, that was done on a somewhat hypothetical basis of what a deal roughly approximate to this one would look like before we knew the detail. Now that we do know the detail of this deal, in terms of process moving forward, could I just ask what impact assessment and what economic scenario planning will the government be doing now that we know the details of this to try and project what the economic damage is going to be?
I think it's a good point. I certainly think that we will want to return to the issue of publishing analysis, as Claire Baker has indicated, once we understand a fair deal more. And I think it would be sensible now that we have the full awful text to run that type of analysis again. So I think it's a good point. And we will do our very best to provide some information. I can't give you a timescale on that. It will depend what information we get and how well informed we are.
Thank you. That's everything from me for the moment, Convener.
Thank you very much. Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you made reference to Ian Duncan-Smith suggesting that this might not be the end of the story and there may be further changes brought forward by the Tory government in London. The EU are describing the process at the moment as a provisional agreement, I understand, whereas the UK government appears to be trying to present it in a rather different light. To what extent, Cabinet Secretary, has the UK government recognised that it's provisional in Europe's terms, and how do they view it? Is it provisional, or is the bill that's before the Westminster Parliament today the final word as they see it?
Yes, it's not a provisional deal as such. Its application is provisional, and that was caused by the difficulty of timing. The European Parliament had said many months ago that it felt that the deadline for putting its process in place, and its process is a complex process. The deal will, the treaty would go to a variety of different committees. Its deadline was essentially Halloween, one of their senior MEPs said to me on the phone one day that they could sort of stretch it to the 3rd of November. By the time you get to Christmas Eve, that is completely impossible. And they had said at the start of that week that they couldn't even do a quick job on it. They felt that that was it. So in order for it to have effect and for there not to be any hiatus in which there would be no transition and it would be essentially a period of no deal, then the terms are provisionally applied by the Commission. The Commission have made it very, very clear that this is a one-off without and does not set a precedent. And there is, some unhappiness that it's had to be like this, unless this is because of the way in which the UK has operated. But as far as the UK are concerned, that is it. I mean, this bill will be passed. We will refuse consent. I would like to think that that was effective, but it won't be. It will simply be brushed aside. The Northern Irish and Welsh are not voting on consent today. They may vote on consent at some stage in future, but that will be irrelevant because in terms of the timescale of the bill. And then that is it, as far as the UK is concerned. Now, there's not even much of a period of grace. There was a lot of discussion about whether there should be a period in which, although the deal was done, there would be a period in which it was essentially disapplied to allow people to get used to it. The UK has said in customs terms that it's not planning to impose much in the first 3 to 6 months. But again, people are going to find, you know, different applications in different places. This is a burach, I'm afraid. But you know, Johnson will, you know, thinks he has his day in the sun, and you know, he'll be grinning all the day in the House of Commons and failing to answer questions. And those who support him in the Scottish Parliament will spin like mad to try and get it over that they've got some great victory. This is a bit like, and Mr. Stevenson, forgive me, but you and I are both old enough to know this. It's a bit like a budget. You know, when a budget passes, usually there's, you know, people say this is the most wonderful thing that has ever been, and it is going to be magnificent for people. And then the truth begins to emerge. And the truth is beginning to emerge about this too. This is awful compared to what we have. I mean, this is dreadful compared to what we have. And it's almost as bad as you could imagine without it being a no deal.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So one might imagine Boris is rather like Icarus. If he flies too close to the sun, the wings will fall off him and he'll plummet to political oblivion on the earth. I want to move on to a technical matter, which is probably for officials to deal with. And that is in relation to the bill that's before Westminster today. Paragraphs 29, 31, 32, and 33. On reading it, I couldn't quite understand what they meant, but my confusion is further heightened when I go to Schedule 6, the consequential provisions, where it makes reference to an insertion of that part of the bill into the Scotland Act 1998. And I'm just very unclear, bluntly. Maybe my reading it a couple of times isn't sufficient. It may require a couple of dozen times. Just what our understanding of these bits are in relation to the legislative competence of Scotland, and more perhaps to the point, the practical effect. So either yourself or your officials, Cabinet Secretary.
I think a lawyer who is fortunately with me would be a good position to do so. As I understand the effect on Schedule 5, it is essentially to do with the ability of Scottish ministers to implement the agreement. So it allows Scottish ministers to implement the agreement because the powers of those ministers are altered by so doing. But let us hear from Graham if he would like to do it, or from Gerald about what the situation. Perhaps Graham first.
Yes, happy to speak, Minister. Thanks. Really just to say that the amendment in Schedule 6 is a fairly straightforward technical amendment, which really just makes sure that the competence of the Scottish Minister's powers is kept wide. And I think I can reassure the member there isn't anything untoward sitting in there. Broadly, what the provisions do in relation to the regulation-making powers in the bill is give the Scottish ministers, where they are given the same powers as UK ministers, a broadly equivalent scope of devolved competence as under the Scotland Act at present. So really, I think you know, those particular provisions just make a technical adjustment to the scope of the powers, just to make clear that the Scottish ministers have powers in this area.
I don't know if there's anything Gerald would want to add.
I think just on those particular parts of the bill that Mr. Stevenson has highlighted, I think this is where perhaps some of our uncertainty about the effects on devolved competence, and also the points Mr. Russell was making earlier about how we will analyse the effects as we go forward, arise from these sections. In particular, Clause 29 is described in the expansion notes as a gloss, which means that it has effect on existing domestic law in a way that we will discover as we go through. And therefore, as the Legislative Consent Memorandum highlights, there is a particular challenge in inviting the Scottish Parliament to consent to that clause when we don't really know its full effects. Similarly, the powers in 31 to 33 are really looking ahead to the implementation of the provisions of the Future Relationship Agreement after day one, which is the 1st of January. So again, how that plays out is something that we will only know as it happens, really. So I think both of those are the bits that we've highlighted for uncertainty in its effects on devolved competence of the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you very much for that, Convener. And if I must get a supplementary, it will be on seed potato industry, which is a very important industry in my constituency and a very valuable one. But that will need to come in supplementaries if time permits. Convener.
Thank you for that, Mr. Stevenson. Actually, we are clipping along at quite a pace, so I think I can allow you your supplementary on seed potatoes now.
Oh, that's very helpful, Convener. In that case, Cabinet Secretary, one of my farmers has a multi-million pound industry in seed potatoes where I've assisted previously in international exports, particularly to the Philippines and Uruguay. But Europe is equally important. Scotland is, for climatic reasons, a leader in producing seed potatoes. To what extent was the exclusion of seed potatoes from exports to the EU a subject of any discussion with Scottish ministers, Cabinet Secretary?
I'll let Mike Nielsen say a word or two about seed potatoes in a moment, but I've been raising this on occasion for, I'd have to check, but certainly 18 months since this, and perhaps more, this became clear that it was a possible issue. And this has happened a lot in the JMC, that, you know, issues have arisen, we have raised them, they have been sagely nodded to by a variety of UK ministers, and then nothing's happened. And that is another example here. I raised the seed potato issue again yesterday within the JMC, and, you know, frankly, I expect nothing to happen about it. It is extraordinary that a whole Scottish industry has essentially been cut out without a by your leave. By the UK government and utterly carelessly, and it is utterly wrong. But Mike might want to say a word or two just in more detail.
Only briefly to say that the outcome on seed potatoes is a consequence of the UK government's decision not to align with EU rules in relation to plant health, with the consequence that the EU is no longer able to agree to imports. So it's the core UK government approach to the deal that has this consequence.
And the alignment on plant health is part of a extraordinary ideological view that sovereignty is only expressed if you don't accept anybody else's opinion. Which is exactly where the UK government has found itself. I mean, it is utterly bizarre.
Thank you very much. We can now move on, and the next questions are from Beatrice Bishop, MSP.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Like others, I'm very concerned about the impact on young people of our leaving the EU. And we know that the UK is now no longer entitled to participate in EU programmes like Horizon Europe and Erasmus. But the agreement does make provision for the UK participation in Horizon during the 2021-27 programme. And also, just the other day, it was announced that the Irish government would pay to facilitate Northern Irish continued participation in Erasmus. So could I ask what the Scottish Government's view is on Scottish organisations' participation in Horizon, and also note that participation in Horizon 2020 fell sharply from 2017 once it was realised there was an intention to leave the EU. And can I also ask for the Government's view on the failure to reach agreement on participation in Erasmus?
Indeed, thank you. On Horizon, we're not entirely clear what status the UK will have. One type of status would allow fairly full participation. One type of status would not. It would be tangential. So there's work still to be done. I understand the difficulty there is that, of course, the final arrangement for the next five-year period has not been reached in the EU, and therefore it is not possible to say exactly how this will work. But we do welcome the fact that there will be some access to Horizon. It's not as good as being a member state, without a doubt, but that we welcome the fact, and it will give the opportunity for certainly not to be, I would be very surprised if we were to be a net beneficiary. I think that's probably out, and we were a net better beneficiary, but there will be some access. On Erasmus, this is absolute vandalism, and we have not seen the value for money assessment that was made. I have asked for it on several occasions, so have the Welsh. We've never seen it. We had the same position as the Welsh on this at the JMC this week and have had for a long time. We believe that participation in Erasmus for the devolved government should be negotiated and should have been negotiated if the UK did not wish participation itself. We were of the understanding, even at the start of December, that membership was likely. We were given to understand that, and therefore it was a surprise when this was actually leaked to a Tory supporting news body some weeks ago, and it became clear that something was going on. I have yesterday said to UK, and this will be followed up, I'm sure, by Richard Lockhead in writing shortly, that our position is clear. We wish now to have the money that the UK spent on Erasmus pro rata for Scotland, taking account of the fact that Scotland benefited more than what it put in. Perhaps we should have a larger share than pro rata. And then we should decide how that money is spent, whether we wish to participate in their new programme, which will be, it's extraordinary that Erasmus being attacked for being elitist. The Turing programme, from what we can see, will be very elitist indeed. And Erasmus is much wider than academic and higher education. And then we can decide, because these are devolved areas, we can decide how we spend the money. And certainly one of the options, if we can arrange it, would be to continue with some sort of association with Erasmus. Difficult to do as a sub-state, but certainly worth trying. But we need the money. And therefore, I've made that clear that we need to get the money from the UK government. That needs to be given to us. And then we'll try and see what we can do.
I certainly don't think that Erasmus is elitist. I know several people in my constituency who have benefited from it, and it's a long-term benefit.
Conservatives to attack anybody who criticises, as we've seen earlier today. It's an attack, an ad hominem attack on those who are critical of the deal, not in any sense a justification of the deal. There can be no justification of the deal as far as Erasmus is concerned or any other part of it.
Thank you. Can I turn now to the mutual recognition of qualifications? I think this is something that was surprising quite a few people. We knew that the Conservatives want to end free movement, but limiting the recognition of professional qualifications doesn't seem a sensible way even to do that. Concerned, there's a number of sectors, the health service, research, where we should be concerned that people would have more difficulty coming to Scotland to do the work that we think is important. So has the Scottish Government done any work to assess the impact on Scottish skill needs?
No, as far as I'm aware, I'm unaware of work on that, because I think everybody expected that this would have to be at the core of any agreement, because it's such a normal part of our lives. This is another illustration of things we have taken for granted for half a century just disappear. There is provision within the agreement to take this issue further. But as I said at the outset in response to the convener, that also, because it's the CETA treaty and nothing has happened about it as yet. So we would want to pursue this, but I think you're right that we should now assess what the impact is likely to be now that we unfortunately see the reality of this.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Our next questions are from Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Hi.
Good morning. Most businesses in my constituency in Scotland are small to medium enterprises, and they're already struggling and having a dreadful time in the face of the COVID pandemic. Given there are no transitional arrangements in this trading arrangement, I understand that's highly unusual, and you in fact state that British trading costs will substantially increase due to additional paperwork and procedures, I suspect many of these small medium enterprises will not have the resources to analyse all these requirements. So what do you think the impact will be on these SMEs with this undoubtedly increased red tape? And if I may sort of tag on, and I'll just do it in a one-er, a second point that arises from this, which deals with small and medium enterprises but other larger businesses, what do you think the impact will be in supply lines for businesses, including also fresh fruit and veg?
Well, I mean, there is undoubtedly a huge issue in terms of some of whom will have very limited connection with Europe and European trading, some of whom will have detailed connection, some of them will think they have no connection and then discover they have. I remember reading about a company some time ago in a Brexit survey, which said that they had no engagement with Europe. And when the form was being looked at by one of our officials, it actually said that their main business was selling Belgian chocolates. So they said, well, you have a substantial engagement. They said, no, we buy them from somebody else. So they hadn't thought through the implication of how their supply chains will be affected. The right thing to have done, well, the right thing to have done was not to have embarked on all, but the right thing to have done in June was to have had an extension. The COVID crisis demanded it. An extension would have allowed more time for people to get used to the ideas, even the bad ideas. That was rejected out of hand. And apparently, this is now a virtue that this did not take place, though I don't think that would be seen by many businesses. What we must now do is redouble our efforts to make sure that businesses are informed and assisted, but it's a limited amount of assistance. We can't fill in the forms for them. And the Scottish Enterprise Get Ready for Brexit website, which has been much used and has a range of analysis tools, is still there, is still available. Scottish Enterprise and others have been supporting companies, even smaller companies, to get ready and to understand what is required. There is a range of information online available. But in the midst of the COVID pandemic, survival of companies has become really, really difficult. And to add this as well at this time, and then to pretend that in some way it's beneficial. I mean, that is a particularly cruel pretense from the Tories. To pretend that in some way this is helping them is disgraceful. Mike Nielsen, I think, can say a word or two about the actual business impact because he's done some work on this. Perhaps if Mike comes in for a moment.
I think the main point I wanted to make was going back to the challenges for SMEs. As Mr. Russell has already indicated, the competing challenge of COVID has made it hard for them to prepare for the things they knew about, which is primarily around potential customs arrangements. But actually, no businesses will have known before Christmas Day what the rules of origins which would apply to their supply chain, nor to the regulatory requirements for their particular sector. So it's very difficult in terms of to make an economic analysis sector by sector, but the overall impact of this level of agreement is reflected in the various forecasts going through to 2030. And what we will be seeing is an enforced reshaping of supply chains for all businesses. And as you say, there will be some businesses which conclude that it is simply too complicated either to deal with the bureaucracy or to completely reshape their supply chains, all of which will squeeze growth in the medium term.
If Christine Graham, I'm quite sure she will not want to do this, but if she was interested, I can point her to a UK government publication yesterday, which started to look at the issues of accumulation, for example, and rules of origin, and ferociously complicated. Even on the issue of grated cheese, which is one of the things they were looking at. Another one was doll's eyes. They are ferociously complicated in terms of something which Mike could explain much more than I could, but I'm not going to ask him to, diagonal accumulation, which then becomes mind-blowing.
I think what's scary about this is, because I go back to my constituency, and we're all actually probably the same in our constituencies. Most businesses, international companies, we'll probably get on top of this one way or another. But all those small businesses are the bedrock of the Scottish economy, which are already clinging to the rock face. And we all know this. To actually have to cope with the complexity, as you just said, of those bespoke rules of origin, I don't think they're going to manage it. And I don't think time is on their side to in the middle of all this, trying to survive is trying to deal with all this. And it may very well be that under all these pressures, some individuals, family businesses and so on, will just give up the ghost because it's just too much to cope with.
It is not impossible to deal with, you know, a massive increase in bureaucracy and forms, rather ironic considering this was meant to be an exercise against bureaucracy. Not impossible, but it takes a lot more time, effort and money. I was talking to a company not so long ago, which the bulk of their business was with the EU, but there was some business in other countries. And when they were sending a shipment to other countries, they told me they put that shipment in the corner of the warehouse. And somebody came and inspected it eventually, and there was a lot of paper filled in, and it took a long time. And you had to plan for it. Well, the stuff they sent out, a person said to me, it could go to Wishaw or Warsaw. It didn't matter. Very simple paperwork. It was all the same. All you had to do was to arrange transport. Now, unless it's going to Wishaw, everything else that's going to the EU becomes like that consignment, where you will wait for inspection. You will wait to fill in the paperwork. You will put it off. You will say, oh, gosh, this is going to be very difficult. Now, that doesn't mean to say that people can't adapt, but I think you are right. I think it will be the last straw for quite a number of businesses.
Thank you very much. I have no further questions.
Thank you very much. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, MSP.
Thanks very much indeed, Convener. And can I just say, morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to turn to agriculture, and I just remind members that I am a partner in a farming business, which is also a member of the NFUS. The seed potato issue, as Stuart Stevenson raised, is disappointing, but I understand that there are negotiations on this continuing. The deal agreed between the EU and the UK avoids damaging tariffs, particularly on our sheep industry, and protects our vital markets. And the deal also recognises UK GIs such as Orkney Cheddar and Arbroath Smokies. And the deal has been welcomed by farmers, and the National Sheep Association has said we should celebrate the agreement. NFUS has said it was a good news that no deal had been averted. So, Cabinet Secretary, why do you believe they're wrong and you're right?
I don't believe they're wrong. It is good news that no deal has been averted, in the sense that it is a tiny little spark of good news amongst a great deal of bad news. And indeed, that statement from the NFUS that you refer to, and I'm sure you weren't trying to be partial, also indicated the considerable difficulties that would exist in additional bureaucracy and additional paperwork. And although there has been no indication that they will de-recognise UK GIs, the government hasn't secured any legally binding protection of the GIs. So in actual fact, the status of those geographical indicators is weaker, well, will be weaker on Friday morning than it was on Thursday night. So this is, it is not as beneficial, not nearly as beneficial as we are experiencing today, as your business experiences. That is going to change for the worse tomorrow night at 11 o'clock. It is going to change for the worse permanently tomorrow night at 11 o'clock. That is not a triumph, that is a disaster.
Thanks for that answer. I mean, I can understand why the Cabinet Secretary wants to try and compare two things which are comparable. The situation we have at the moment, or previously as a member of the EU, and obviously looking forward. But the comparison is actually between the deal that that's been negotiated and a no-deal Brexit. And I think there should be more clarity perhaps on that. Can I turn then to the preparedness, as I think was raised previously, and also businesses? There's been a number of issues, obviously, and I think you've raised them yourself today. But the FSB has said the deal is a huge relief. CBI has said a deal means we can start our new chapter outside of the EU on a better foundation. And the British Chambers of Commerce said that we should have speedy ratification to end the uncertainty. Now, there are obviously going to be issues, and we saw that the UK government, or the Scottish government, had received £200 million for Brexit preparedness. Can you tell us how that has been allocated, and whether that has all been allocated, and any issues that you had in using that money?
We've accounted for that money in statements that we've made, and I'm sure that Kate Forbes will be willing and entirely willing at the Finance Committee and at this committee to go through the government accounts and how we have spent money. What I will not do is account for that money to the UK government as if we had gone cap in hand to receive it. We should have received a great deal more money to cope with what we're having to cope with in Brexit, a great deal more, and I hope we will receive a great deal more money.
Right. But can sorry, I just, Governor Secretary,
Can I just move, please, back one step? You said at the beginning of your question that the comparison has to be between a no deal and the deal we've got. That is not true. The comparison has to be with the situation that we have now, today, and which will stop tomorrow night at 11 o'clock. And what then takes place? It is, and I'm sure you don't mean this, the merest sleight of hand to pretend that that did not happen. What is happening is the good things that we have had as membership of the EU, and there are many of them, will disappear. And we did not vote for them. In actual fact, Orkney did not vote for them because no local authority area in Scotland voted for them by a majority.
Yes, I mean, it's interesting talking about sleight of hand, but as I say, this is about a no deal scenario, leaving the transition period. We've left the EU. Brexit's already happened, and there seems to. I'm sorry, are you suggesting that we haven't left the EU, Cabinet Secretary?
No, because well, we should have left the EU, and we did not vote for it. That's what I am suggesting. What?
Yeah, I do appreciate your position on that, and you've made it very, very clear. But you've also repeatedly stated, and members of your government have repeatedly stated, we shouldn't be leaving on a no deal scenario. It would be disastrous. No deal is any deal is better than no deal. But here you are in a position where you're advocating voting against the only deal on the table. And not only that, I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary. Let me just finish.
Have you never heard of the prerogative?
And also, Cabinet Secretary. This is a deal, not only, this is not just a UK deal, this is a UK-EU deal, it's agreed between two. So your events, you're essentially calling us to vote against.
They got a good deal.
Cabinet Secretary, it would help actually if you just listened, and then once I've finished speaking, you could give your answer, as you're very much entitled to do. You're voting against a deal that has been agreed between the UK and the EU. So why have the EU... Why are you voting against the EU part of the deal as well? Surely you should understand the implications of that.
Well, they got a very good deal. I mean, you know, if I was sitting in Belgium or sitting in France or sitting in Finland or in any one of the 27, I think they got a great deal. Because if you set the deal down on one side and you set Barnier's mandate down on the other side, he got what he came for. He got exactly what he came for. I mean, the UK's negotiating position just went nowhere. But actually, I'm not. You're from Orkney. I'm in Argyll. It's an awful deal. It's an awful deal for fishermen. It's an awful, awful deal for Scotland's young people. It's an awful deal for agriculture. It's an awful deal, and it's a particularly bad deal compared to what we have now. And that is the comparison.
That's a false comparison.
We have now, and it is
Is it an awful deal compared to no deal, which is what essentially you're advocating? There is a deal on the table.
I have repeatedly said I did not wish no deal, and there won't be a no deal because under
the prerogative. You'll vote no deal this afternoon.
I'm sure you have heard of the prerogative. If you have heard of the prerogative, you will realise that this will be signed no matter what. Even if every single person in the House of Commons today voted against the deal, including Boris Johnson, he could trog round to Downing Street and sign it. Apparently, the deal is going to come, the document is going to come by RAF aircraft. And it is going to be signed by him, and it's going to be signed by him under the prerogative. So the reality is, trying the ad hominem attack on everybody who is opposed to the deal is not a good way to go forward. Justify the deal. Justify the deal according to what we have now. That actually, Mr. Halko Johnson, would be an impossibility even for you.
Well, so what you're happy to be in a situation when the NFU, National Sheep Association, the FSB, the CBI, BCC, the British Chambers of Commerce are all wrong and you're right.
No, they're absolutely right to say, and I have agreed with them. Gosh, we're just winding ourselves.
You're just ignoring them. Agreeing them and ignoring them.
I agree with them that I'm glad that they have avoided a no deal. That was foolishness on the part of the UK government to get so close to it.
Okay. Well, listen, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that. I think I probably used my time, convener.
Thank you very much. Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And I agree with you, we shouldn't just sign up to any old rubbish that's put in front of us. Now, whilst the deal addresses tariff barriers, it doesn't include any sort of agreement in terms of non-tariff barriers. And exporters will have to produce goods that satisfy the requirements of importing countries and provide paperwork that show these requirements are met, such as rules of origin, customs formalities and regulatory checks and controls for safety, health and other public policy purposes. So what impact will that have on Scotland?
Oh, very substantial. I mean, you know, the reality of the situation, I might say a word about these four issues within any trading arrangement. But, you know, tariffs are only one of them. Non-tariff barriers are very significant indeed, and regulatory alignment is extremely important. And of course, that is why, you know, we could not part of the single market, because we would not accept regulatory alignment. But regulatory alignment is vital. And the regulatory alignment also allows for the highest of standards. But if Mike can talk you through these four areas, then I think we will all benefit from that, because they are all vital, not just tariffs and tariff barriers.
Okay, I think starting point is, for a business, it's obviously the whole operating environment which is critical. So it's the overall effect of those Brexit factors, but lots of other factors, including the enormous headwinds that COVID has had for the same businesses. But if we look at just the three of those, and in particular the regulatory barriers, the impact of having to comply twice rather than once. Then on the customs, the bureaucracy and delay involved, and coming back to the rules of origin, where there's 50 pages in the agreement and 97 different sectors are referred to, it's the combination of those which make the operating environment so much more challenging. So it takes you back into the overall impact on viability and activity that has been that we've talked about before. Can I just there's one other point I maybe make about the EU perspective on the deal, because the EU's mandate was on the basis of the choices made by the UK government in terms of European Court of Justice, in terms of complete freedom, in terms of regulatory alignment. Their mandate was the sort of relationship that was possible if the UK imposed those red lines. And as Cabinet Secretary made clear, that mandate has been fulfilled. But I think if you listen to President von der Leyen when she announced the outcome of the deal, it was certainly quite a solemn perspective, and there is no doubt that if the UK had been wanting to participate in the single market and the customs union, then the EU would have been delighted, and all of the four factors in full economic access would have been dealt with.
Thank you. So clearly Scotland businesses will be at a competitive disadvantage. Can I move on to the another aspect of the agreement? It doesn't actually include UK continued access to the Schengen Information System, which is the EU's information sharing system for security and border management and used by police and border guards to enter and consult alerts on persons or objects. So what impact will that have on the fight against, for example, organised crime and people trafficking?
It will have a severe effect. I mean, I wasn't astonished, because I'm not astonished by anything, government minister. But we should have been astonished to hear Priti Patel claim that this, the deal would improve security. The opposite is true. It will weaken security. Because the access to real-time information on the Schengen Information System was very important. Scotland has also been a very proactive contributor to coordination of justice. I mean, we had an officer embedded in Europol, which was very, very helpful to us indeed. All that becomes weaker. It's not that there aren't alternatives. There are alternatives, but the alternatives are less good. The European arrest warrant has been particularly effective in terms of Scottish administration of justice. That is no longer there. There is an alternative, not as good. And that is, that's a fallacy of the position that Jamie Halkrow Johnson had taken up, that the comparison was with a no deal. No, the comparison is what we had. And the comparison in terms of law enforcement and our safety is after 11 o'clock tomorrow night, we will be less safe than we were beforehand. And that is simply a fact, because we do not have access to some of the tools that we will have up until 11 o'clock tomorrow night.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, the agreement seeks to ensure that the UK and the EU have equal access to each other's public procurement markets. However, according to the UK government, and I quote, the agreement ensures that the UK can maintain a separate and independent procurement regime and will enable the government to enact reform of our system. What's your understanding of procurement and how it's going to operate following the agreement?
I have to say I don't have an understanding of that. I don't know if Mike has. An area we will still have to do some work on. The procurement issue has been difficult during these last 4 years, four and a bit years I've been involved in this, because our view is that procurement is devolved, and the UK has increasingly tried to say that procurement isn't devolved. So there will be continued disputes about this. But I don't know whether Mike has studied that section of the agreement or not, or whether we have to come back to it.
I think, I mean, this is a bit of a late entry into the overall deal, I think, as part of the package at the end. And it is true that there will be a distinct UK procurement legal basis, which will not have to be dynamically aligned with the EU. But the agreement does give both sides in some sectors the capacity to compete for public sector procurement, and it does go a little bit further than what would be the case under the WTO. In principle, it shouldn't impinge on the devolved powers, but as the Cabinet Secretary said, that it's an area where there is some degree of internal dispute.
Now, financial services are critical to the Scottish economy, and they'll no longer benefit from passporting, so may have to follow the rules of each individual state. And of course, equivalence doesn't cover the same range of financial service activities. Core banking services such as lending, payments and deposit taking are excluded from the agreement, and neither does the agreement guarantee permanent access rights, so the EU can withdraw equivalent determinations with 30 days notice. Now, given the huge importance to Scotland of financial services, particularly Roscoe, having touched on services more generally, I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary can advise what he believes will be the impact on financial services if an agreement in that area cannot be reached over the next few months.
Well, it will be disadvantageous, hugely disadvantageous for Scotland if it can't be agreed. And, there are difficulties in reaching that agreement. I mean, one of the things you have to think about is if there have been this period of negotiation and no agreement is reached, is that because there simply hasn't been time, in which case what effect has it had on the things that have been reached, or is it because there are fundamental problems in reaching it? And that's what we don't know as yet. So this is one of the areas Claire Baker referred to, where the jury will be out for some considerable time. But there is already a disadvantage, as I've indicated, in terms of passporting.
Now, the UK government has poo-pooed the issue of migration, Cabinet Secretary, saying that other people can be trained to fulfil the jobs that migrants currently take up in Scotland, even though, for example, 25% of academics or universities are EU citizens. But in paragraph 21 of your LCM document, you say that the expert advisory group on migration and population predict migration will fall up to 50%, with severe consequences for key sectors such as distribution, hospitality, food processing, manufacturing, the public sector, including the NHS and social care. And reduced EU migration will make Scotland poorer. How do we actually begin to tackle the gaps that these reductions in migration will make? Because clearly we have real issues, and specifically in islands and rural communities, in dealing with some of these particular matters.
Well, you're absolutely right. And of course, you represent some islands. I represent even more islands. I am familiar with these problems. In addition, you have the horticultural industry. But not just that. You have highly skilled workers in academia, in the NHS, in a variety of sectors. And there are two things operating here. There's a push and the pull factor. We've seen that operating over a period of time. There's a push factor that people are saying, well, actually, I'm not welcome here. I feel disadvantaged here and I don't want to be here. Now, we don't want them to say that. You know, we will be reinforcing, and Jenny, Ruth is taking on responsibility for migration now. We will be reinforcing the work that we do with EU citizens to try and persuade them to stay. And of course, the First Minister issued a very powerful statement last week on this, and we are very keen that they stay. But there's also the pull factor, and it's a pull away where people say, can I do better elsewhere? You know, and I mean, that applies in every sector of the economy. It applies for people who are working in, you know, strawberry picking in Angus, because there is a shortage of agricultural and horticultural labour across the state. So if you can't, you can get a job anywhere. And there's a shortage in, and there's a problem in academia at the highest levels, because people will say, well, actually, how will my career be affected by working here if I can't take part in some of the really big collaborations, because, you know, the UK is becoming more distant from EU and EU funding. Maybe I'd be better working somewhere else. So this is a huge problem. I don't think it's amenable to a short-term solution. The longer-term solution for Scotland is to rejoin and to re-enter a system that has freedom of movement, which is immensely beneficial, not just for people coming in, but for all of us going elsewhere. I mean, we haven't even touched on, you know, the issue of the queues at airports, which are inevitable out of this. You know, we're not going to be able to use the electronic gates, so there will be bigger queues at airports. We're not touched upon the issue of what happens with travel insurance and driving licenses, which we haven't touched upon the question of whether or not mobile roaming will still be available, which is, I think, questionable now. You know, these are all beneficial things from freedom of movement that we have experienced, that our children have experienced, which we thought people would go on experiencing. And those are going. I mean, I go back to this idea, the comparison, according to Jamie Helker-Johnson, is a no deal or this deal. No, the comparison is what we had. And what we had was immensely beneficial for business and for individuals.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks very much for your indulgence, Convener.
Thank you very much, Christine Graham. We have a supplementary from you. Are you still there?
Yes, I am. Yes, thank you. It was actually the Cabinet Secretary kind of preempted my thoughts on the European arrest warrant. Criminal law is devolved, as we know. And if I remind the Cabinet Secretary of a high-profile case some years ago of a young woman who was murdered in Scotland by a man from Poland. He fled home. The European arrest warrant was so efficient. They managed to detain him, and it wasn't so much detaining the man as managing to detain his clothing, because the DNA on it was absolutely crucial in convicting him of this horrendous crime. My concern is, because that was so swift, key in preserving evidence, I'm very, you know, anxious that we've lost the European arrest warrant and its capabilities. So can I ask, was there any discussion by the UK government with the Crown Office, the Police Scotland, and indeed the Scottish Government with regard to maintaining this very, very important legal device?
I think it's important to the answer is no, but I think it's important to understand the process. We've not influenced associations. We've raised issues. You know, we've discussed issues. We've said these are important issues to us. At the start of this process, four and a bit years ago, the JMCEN process, there was meant to be a very structured approach to issues, that we would discuss issues. Each meeting would discuss different issues. It also went by the wall. We got tied down into other matters. We constantly kept saying, look, you need to remember this, you need to remember that. We would say, particularly in a run-up to the Chequers event in 2018, I think it was, when we would say, look, these are the issues that you need to bear in mind. Most recently, we provided essentially a shopping list of what we thought were the most essential things that needed to be taken account when things were going badly off the rails. You know, for the UK government, we needed, these are essential things, essential tasks. There's been no systematic approach to this. But what we tried to do is to make it clear that where there was an area of devolved competence, then the Scottish view had to be taken into account. It has not been. And the UK's view has been this is a matter of international association, and therefore, you know, you can go hang.
Can I therefore ask, and you may not be able to answer this, Cabinet Secretary, maybe one for the Justice Secretary, is what will take its place? Because when I gave you that example, key was not keeping,
yes, getting no.
Much as preserving the evidence, which could have been destroyed within hours, and that was key to his conviction. So what will happen now?
I think the Justice Secretary should provide you or the committee with a briefing. I was at a briefing by justice officials and others a couple of weeks ago when the alternatives were being talked about and how things would operate. Somewhat of a depressing event given what the vulnerabilities now will be, but I think the Justice Secretary should give you that information, and maybe the committee will wish to take evidence on that specific issue from perhaps the Justice Secretary and the Lord Advocate, because they are both involved in it.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, we have a little bit of time left, but I would imagine you've got quite a lot to do today. But I did want to ask you about a couple of issues that we've not covered. With regards to freedom of movement, we are the Culture Committee, of course, and you perhaps aware that actors, musicians, comedians have raised the alarm in recent days, because although the agreement does give some professions visa-free travel, that is not extended to creative industries. And I think something like 170,000 people have now signed a petition calling for a cultural visa, which would allow travel and touring throughout Europe. Is that something you're aware of? Is it something that you had the opportunity to discuss with the UK government?
We haven't as yet discussed it with the UK government, but I'm very aware of it. It seems to be yet another disadvantage from compared to what we have now, that there is no possibility of this visa-free travel for people who are whose internationalism is part of their DNA, who require to go to other places and to come from other places, and that enriches us. And that is a very foolish omission. Whether it is an accidental or deliberate omission, it's a foolish omission.
Thank you very much. And also, in the past, Michael Gove has said that Northern Ireland was getting the best of both deals, and you have previously called for Scotland to get a similar deal to Northern Ireland. Now that you've seen the agreement, what's your view on the position of Scotland vis-a-vis Northern Ireland?
Oh, I think it is very weak in relative terms. I mean, first of all, essentially Northern Ireland will have the benefits of being in the single market and the customs union, which was what we suggested should happen to Scotland back in December 2016. And that would have been, not as good as being a full member, would have been a very significant improvement on what this deal actually is. There are issues in terms of fisheries, there are issues in terms of agriculture, there are issues in terms of materials going backwards and forwards. Quite obviously, there are issues in terms now of Erasmus, a whole variety of things. It is at a major advantage, and in addition, it would be a place where people would invest, because they will get the best of both worlds. I think it's not an irony, because irony is too weak a word. I think it is notable that of the countries who voted against, Northern Ireland voted against Brexit and has special status, and it should have, and I'm not objecting. Gibraltar voted against. There's still no agreement on the Gibraltar situation, which is very worrying. Tomorrow night at 11 o'clock could be very serious for Gibraltarians, but there is work being done, and that work would include, I understand, Gibraltar within the Schengen area, which they have long sought, and will be a benefit to them. The people who have had will be Scotland. Nothing at all. Now, I think that far from what we've heard from the Tories in your committee today, seeking to attack anybody who criticises the agreement, they must answer for that. They must answer for their abject failure to secure anything for Scotland at all. In fact, not only, I think, a minus quantity, because what they promised, the one area of interest which they talked about, any Tory near a microphone for the last 4 years has talked about fishing in Scotland. It's all they've talked about. How they were going to protect fishing, they failed, completely failed. In actual fact, as a number of people have now said from the industry itself, it's actually in parts worse than the CFP. So they must answer. And I hope this afternoon in the chamber will be the start of that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We've had no other members indicating that they wish to ask supplementaries. And so I'd like to thank you and your officials for attending and giving your evidence today. You've certainly given us lots to think about. The committee will now consider its response to the LCM in private. And that concludes the public part of the meeting. Thank you very much.